Hello, I'm Julia Farley. I'm the curator of the European Iron Age collections at the British Museum. And welcome to my corner. One of my favourite things about the job that I do as curator of the Iron Age collections is that I get to share with all of you guys the things that I know and that I've gradually been learning about all of the incredible objects that are in the collections of the British Museum, particularly Iron Age and Roman gold and silver working. And some of the objects that I was interested in learning about how they were made are torcs, or big metal neck rings, like this one. I'm able to pick this one up in my hands and be quite relaxed with it, because this isn't part of our collection. This is actually an object which I made. And I wanted to learn about what was needed, if you're starting from first principles, to make a neck ring like this. This one is just about the simplest kind of torque that you can get. And so I wanted to be able to demonstrate for you how I made it. It took quite a long time, and I started with casting a bar of bronze. This one, the Iron Age ones tend to be made of gold and silver, but it turns out that those are quite expensive metals to work with, particularly if you're just beginning. So I went with bronze, cheaper alternative. They're actually slightly harder to work with. It's a much sort of stiffer metal and harder to forge. So you cast out an ingot, and once that's cooled down, then you hammer it into a long, thick piece of wire or rod. And they were forged out, we think, with a square section. So you can hammer down one side, rotate, hammer down the other side, rotate, hammer down the other side, until you're gradually forging out this square piece of wire. One of the things that this made me realise is how incredibly difficult it is to make wire by hand in this way. I may have given up in the end and done some of this wire making on a rolling mill, which they wouldn't have had in the Iron Age, because it's a very, very labour-intensive task. And I think it really made me realise that all of these things are not one person jobs. So everything from kind of, smelting that copper, where you've got to be keeping your bellows going for a very, very long time, to maintaining the furnace, keeping all of that, charcoal ready into hand and keeping your temperatures ready for working objects like this, and doing all of that hammering to make very, very large quantities of very, very standard wire. Some of these are quite easy jobs. Some are very skilled jobs, but all of them are jobs that would require, I think, quite a large number of people to actually be able to produce several different objects. The next step, once you have a piece like this, you need to have two pieces. And so the first thing to do then is to bend the ends of each one round into a loop by taking your thicker rod and hammering it over something called a mandrel, which is a kind of conical piece that you can hammer onto. So I'm just bending that round into two little loops at the end. And these are going to make the kind of loops that we see on the finished torque terminal there. Okay, so I've more or less got one and another one that I made earlier. So you then take these are not particularly well matched, but hopefully you'll get the idea. And the next step in making this is to clamp together two of those opposing loops. So you can start to see how those are going to become those there, obviously on a much larger scale. And the next thing to do would be to twist this. And by twisting and twisting and twisting those paired terminals there together, you gradually build up a twist which runs all the way down the wires. So once you put the twist in, the next thing to do is just very simply to bend the torque round. And you can see then that you end up with something like this. We don't know a huge amount about how they were worn or who wore them, because in Britain in particular, we don't have very many graves from the Iron Age. And so we don't have burials of people wearing torques. When we do find torques like this, they tend to be found in hoards. And this means that we just get a big group of objects like this, perhaps pieces of ancient jewellery, pieces of metalworking waste, and pieces of chopped up items like this, deposited together in a pit. And that's where a lot of the material from Snettisham in Norfolk, where the talk that I based this one on, comes from. So that kind of information by itself, we can look at the objects and say that they were worn, but we can't say who wore them, or whether they were worn only for special occasions, or whether even they were worn every day. Some of the talks that we have, I think, probably weren't for everyday wear. I've explained that I based my replica on the pretty much the simplest kind of talk that you can get. But I have another replica, which I'd like to show you, which is a little bit more complex and not one that I made. This is an electrotype of the Snettisham Great Torc. So it's from the same site. Rather than being made up, as mine was, of just two twisted together large thick wires, this is made up of 64 strands of gold alloy wire, and that's created this incredible neck ring. And at the ends here, what we call the terminals, you can see these are incredibly complex, and they have been directly cast on to the ends of the wire. In this particular one, as I've said, it's an electrotype, so here these ends have actually been soldered on. But on the original, our scientists here at the museum have studied it, and they've realised that actually this part of the terminal was cast directly onto the ends, and this here being added as a little collar to kind of cover up that join. And the way that you'd have to go about casting something like that on, so if I wanted to cast on a more decorative terminal to the one that I'd made, I would put something like a material like wax, which can be melted away, onto the terminals, and I would mould it up and carve it into the shape that I wanted the final terminal to take. And then around that wax, I would pack clay with little funnels into which I can pour metal, as that's going to happen in a moment, and a little hole for the wax to escape from. You then heat up that whole mold, and the wax drains out, it melts with the heat, leaving a void where you want to have that metal going. You then have your molten metal in a crucible, and you can pour that into the mold that you have created. And when you then break away the clay mold, you'll have on there the terminal that you wanted to cast on. And this is an incredibly complicated process, and it can go wrong quite easily, not necessarily because you've done something very wrong, but just because it's quite a tricky process to get right. And so if you imagine trying to cast on something as complicated as that terminal onto all of this incredibly precious wire, that would have been a really kind of daunting and quite a daring thing to do. I used to be, when I first looked at this object, I've always thought it was an absolutely brilliant object. It's one of the real kind of star pieces in our Iron Age gallery. And I always just used to look at the terminals, and I used to look at this decoration, this fabulous engraving that you can see on here. And this is an example of what today we quite often call Celtic art or Latin art. But now that I've done some actual metalworking, the thing that I really look at most now when I see this object is all of this wire, because for me it was so difficult, like physically taxing, and you know, very, very difficult to get the very, very simple, very thick wire that I made to be even and to look nice. The idea of creating this much wire, hammering it all out by hand, and making it so accurately refined and so standardized across the entire length. To me, that's absolutely incredible. And I think that it's quite easy to look at something like that now, and you know, it looks quite simple and quite rope-like, and we can forget all of the hours and hours and hours of work that must have gone into making it. So for me, that was something really important that I got from actually making things, was realizing what goes into this from kind of first principles, and not just taking the finished object for granted, but thinking about really the people who made these objects and what it must have meant for them to make them, and also to wear and to use them as well. Thank you.